why can't we travel faster than light? Because C is the limit. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the first International Space Racing Championship. Please fasten your seatbelts because we are going to start in a few minutes. I see that you're coming from different parts of the world, and this is beautiful. Before we start, we would like to remind you that there is only one rule for space racing. You can't go faster than the speed of light. The C constant, it's the limit. Also, everybody knows that in trying to reach that enormous speed, some weird things would happen, and I'm pretty sure nobody here wants to be shrunk into a tiny volume. It's not our fault, it's just how things are. Everything was well described and explained by Einstein's relativity theory, and although it seems counterintuitive, we all accept the fact that the speed of light is the same in all reference systems and that nothing can go faster than C. Why is that? Why can't we travel faster than light? Follow me on this journey to know more about this topic, but just remember, C is the limit.
What is the most massive galaxy in the universe? Hard to say, but we can tell you which is the most massive in the local group. The local group is one of many galaxy clusters in the universe and the home of our Milky Way. For a long time, it was thought that our neighbor, the Andromeda Galaxy, had the most mass. It is bigger, has more stars, and so on. The latest research, however, assumes that our Milky Way has the most mass, although it has about 600 billion stars less. However, the most mass contributes the dark matter, and of it, our Milky Way possesses clearly more. Was this short fact interesting for you? Well, it was presented by today's sponsor of the video, Infinity. Infinity is a free newsletter that regularly provides you with exciting articles on the topics of space, nature, technology, and the latest from the world of science. Short and compact so that everyone understands it. Stay up to date on the latest discoveries and get interesting facts you didn't know yet. Of course, with unique storytelling, so it will not be boring for you. Sometimes there are also exclusive interviews with interesting personalities who can give you insider and background knowledge on the topics. It's the newsletter for all dreamers. Click on the link in the description and sign up for free.
It has long been believed that light has an infinite speed. Daily experience would seem to confirm this. As soon as a lamp is turned on, the light instantly floods the space. However, as early as the 17th century, the Danish astronomer Ole Rømer hypothesized that light had an enormous, but not quite infinite, speed. Before him, Galileo Galilei had also tried his hand, but without success. Galileo's experiment involved placing two lanterns at a distance of 1 mile and calculating the time it took the light to get from one point to the other. Together with an assistant, he took a shielded lantern and went to the top of two hills that were a mile away. Galileo discovered that his lantern and the assistant on the other hill, as soon as he saw the light, discovered the lantern in his turn. The Pisan scientist would therefore have to have measured the time needed to see the light from the other hill, and at that point it would have been enough to divide the distance by the time to obtain the speed of light. The experiment did not lead to any results. To travel a mile, light takes about 0.000005 seconds, an immeasurable value with the tools at Galileo's disposal. Rømer, working at the Paris Observatory, was not looking for the speed of light when he found it. Instead, he was compiling extensive observations of the orbit of the Io, the innermost of the four big satellites of Jupiter discovered by Galileo in 1610. By timing the eclipse of the Io by Jupiter, Rømer hoped to determine a more accurate value for the satellite's orbital period. Such observations had practical importance in the 17th century. Galileo himself had suggested that tables of orbital motion of Jupiter's satellites would provide a kind of clock in the sky. Navigators and map makers anywhere in the world might use this clock to read the absolute time, the standard time at a place of known longitude, like the Paris Observatory. Then, by determining the local solar time, they could calculate their longitude from the time difference. This method of finding longitude eventually turned out to be impractical and was abandoned after the development of accurate seagoing timepieces. But the Io eclipse data unexpectedly solved another important scientific problem: the speed of light. The orbital period of Io is known to be 1.769 Earth days. The satellite is eclipsed by Jupiter once every orbit, as seen from Earth. By timing these eclipses over many years, Romer noticed something peculiar. The time interval between successive eclipses became steadily shorter as the Earth and its orbit moved towards Jupiter and became steadily longer as the Earth moved away from Jupiter. These differences accumulated. From his data, Romer estimated that when the Earth was nearest to Jupiter, at E1, the eclipses of Io would occur about 11 minutes earlier than predicted based on the average orbital period over many years, and 6.5 months later, when the Earth was farthest from Jupiter, at E2, the eclipses would occur about 11 minutes later than predicted. Romer knew that true orbital period of Io could have nothing to do with the relative positions of the Earth and Jupiter. In a brilliant insight, he realized that the time difference must be due to the finite speed of light. That is, light from Jupiter's system has to travel farther to reach the Earth when the two planets are on opposite sides of the Sun than when they're closer together. Romer estimated that the light required 22 minutes to cross the diameter of Earth's orbit. The speed of light could then be found by dividing the diameter of Earth's orbit by the time difference. The Dutch scientist, Christian Huygens, who first did the arithmetic, found a value for the speed of light equivalent to 131,000 miles per second. The correct value is actually 186,000 miles per second. The difference was due to errors in Romer's estimate for the maximum time delay. The correct value is 16.7, not 22 minutes. And also, too imprecise knowledge of the Earth's orbital diameter. More important than the exact answer, however, was the fact that Romer's data provided the first quantitative estimate for the speed of light, and was in the right ballpark at least. Romer returned to Denmark in 1681, where he pursued a distinguished career in both science and government. He designed and built the most accurate astronomical instruments of his time and made extensive observations. He later served as mayor and prefect of police of Copenhagen and ultimately as head of the state council. Romer is remembered today, of course, not for his high political office, but for being the first person to measure the speed of light. Now, we have a question to answer. Why can't we go faster than the speed of light? To answer this question, we have to recall some of Einstein's relativity. In 1905, Einstein proposed two postulates. The first is that the laws of nature are the same in all inertial reference frames, i.e. those frames moving at a constant velocity with respect to one another, in which an object with no net forces on it will appear at rest. The second postulate states that an observer in any inertial reference frame will measure the speed of light in a vacuum to be the same. From his theory, Einstein derived length contraction as well as the time dilation, the equivalents of mass and energy, and more. In particular, he realized that an observer at rest on a high-speed train will measure the length of a passing high-speed train as shortened in the direction of its motion by the so-called Lorentz factor. That's 1 minus v squared over c squared to the 1/2 power, where v is the relative velocity between the observer and the other train. Paradoxically, an observer on that train will measure the first as shortened by the same factor. Isn't special relativity fun? You can see by yourself what would happen if you reached the speed of light. The Lorentz factor would become zero. That is, your length would shrink to zero in the direction of motion. Time dilation indicates that, for an observer in the inertial frame of reference, a clock that is moving relative to them will be measured to tick slower than a clock that is at rest in the frame of reference. This case is sometimes called special relativistic time dilation. The faster the relative velocity, the greater the time dilation between one another, with the rate of time reaching zero as one approaches the speed of light, which is 299,792,458 meters a second. We're almost done, but we would like to give you a more precise explanation. If you surfed the net Googling why nothing can go faster than light, you probably get lots of answers saying, mass would increase to infinity, which would require infinite energy to accelerate, and so on and so on. But you can ignore those. Somehow, the only part of relativity that sticks for a non-physicist is the relativistic mass increase concept, which causes so much confusion that real physicists usually don't even use it anymore. The real answer is that you can go as fast as you want. Do you want to go to Andromeda, 2.5 million light years away, in an hour? Go for it. You've got some incredible engineering problems to conquer, but relativity won't get in your way. However, some odd things will happen along the way. Number 1. No matter how fast you go, light still acts the same. Its speeds away from you are exactly c in every direction, as if you're standing still, because in your reference frame, you are standing still. Number 2. In your reference frame, you're standing still and the universe is moving past you at some incredible speed. Due to length contraction, the universe gets compacted in the direction of travel, and so Andromeda is not 2.5 million light years away anymore. In fact, it's less than a light hour away, about 670 million miles, which means you can get there in an hour without ever exceeding the speed of light. Number 3. For the folks back at home, your time seems slowed down. You may think it only took an hour, but to them, it took you over 2.5 million years. So again, you've never exceeded the speed of light. So as you can see, no one ever sees anything moving faster than the speed of light. It's not that something keeps you from going as fast as you want, it's that no matter how fast you go, time and space rearrange themselves in such a way that no one, you or the folks back home, or anyone else, ever sees anything going faster than the speed of light. And it has nothing to do with mass increase or needing infinite energy or anything like that. As you can see, we are living in an amazing universe, where often reality seems to exceed fantasy. And we think it's beautiful that, making science, we can go deeper and deeper in our understanding of the universe. All of the effort we put into understanding and making science, it's always well repaid. Science will never disappoint us. Well, the video ends here. Thanks for watching, everyone. What do you think about the speed of light? Does it amaze you? Let us know in the comments below.